Very, very, very warm welcome, digital welcome from the Creative Village here in Amsterdam. We're very happy to have you here in this Inspire session. As you see, it's quite lonely out here, but we will make it count, and we hope for a lot of interaction with you guys to start working towards our topic of the day. The topic of the day is about shifting your business model. And it's about where you are now in your business and towards the shift towards the edge, towards new business models that you can go. The business model canvas is the underlayer in the models and in the way we work and in our methodology. We started out 10 years ago together with Alex creating the business model canvas, and it's really a tool for us to show and guide companies into shifts that are happening. And one of those shifts we are going to go into today, and it's actually an update of the book that we are writing at the moment and will be published by the end of the year, where we identified six major shifts that are going on. And today it is all about the digital shift, shifting away from a physical business model towards a digital business model. And today I'm going to talk about it together with Roland, with you. And of course, we are looking into also who we have in the room. But first, let us introduce ourselves. So behind me is Roland. He is one of the authors of the book about business model shift. And he will be guiding us through our point of view on this, and is going to guide you and help you also to understand what we see and how does it work. My name is Michiel. I'm also a strategy designer here at Business Models Inc. In the Dutch team. I have a background in IT. I have quite a history at Microsoft, been there for 15 years, and truly believe that the digital technology is changing companies, but it should be done in a way that it really creates value. So we're going to emphasize this during our hour today, and love to also know who we have in the room. So we also asked a question on who we have in the room. So the most of us here in the room, we're not driving, but we're a part of the team that was driving the business model shift before Corona hit us all. So it's about 50% of us was working partly in the digital shift. There were a smaller percentage, like a percent of 2%, who was really in the driver's seat driving that digital shift within the company. And there were a lot of people that where the company was shifting, but others were doing this. That was also part of what we have. Luckily, there's nobody here, Roland, in the call that was just only pushing the current business model, the physical business model. So very cool to all have you here. You already met the chat on the right side of your screen when you filled out this question. We're going to use it during the session more. We like to get your feedback. It's being moderated by Kira, one of our colleagues somewhere else in our beautiful country. Any questions, any help, anything that you want, drop Kira the question, and she will help you publish it or put it another way. If you see interesting questions coming up or remarks that you like, please also use the thumb up, because then it's being ranked higher up and the chance will be bigger and bigger that we will call it out here in the discussion, so when we go on. So let's jump into the presentation, because what are we going to do today with you? So as said, we like to share our point of view with you. We also like to show you some examples of where we see this digital shift happening and see how you relate to it. We will highlight one story where we go in depth, and also like your feedback there, what's your aha moments there. And the story we're going to highlight it has something to do with learning. And it has something to do with the question, what if everybody could learn for free in the whole world? That means that we are moving away from overpriced courses where you pay and you're very excited that you are going to do the course. You submit the money, start doing the course, and after 1 or 2 weeks, you really feel left. And there is nobody that's pushing you or trying to make you go faster. And in the end, after the course, you didn't learn what you wanted to learn. You didn't learn the language. And on the other hand, you also feel, was this really valuable to you? So what we want to show you is a way to do that differently. It's the story of Duolingo. So that's where we want to dive into with you. And afterwards, we also like to drive some interaction. We like to get questions from you. And you can drop the question anytime in the chat on the right side of your screen. And we will get those questions and work on it. Because we do miss you guys. This is how it normally was here on the here in the back. Roland is here now alone. So please work with us. Let's make it a Business Models Inc. session and do a lot of interaction together to drive the conversation and make the most of our time together. So that said, I'm very curious if you're ready to go and dive into the topic together, because the world is changing and is changing fast. This is how I grew up watching television on Friday night with my family. And we always had a kind of a fight who was allowed to call out what's going to be watched on a Friday night. Do you recognize this, Roland?
Well, I didn't have a fight because my brother and I, we loved the A-Team.
Ah, okay. So Roland had only one brother and they watched the A-Team at Friday night. And in our home, it was more of a fight because I also had a sister. So it was on the one hand, the honeymoon show, or on the other hand, it was the A-Team. So those times are not there anymore. Not in my home, that is. I have three beautiful children, one daughter, two boys. And what I see is that they have their own way, their own channel to the world. They have their own iPads and they can choose and pick whatever they do and whatever they watch. So the mindset for them has become totally different in this way. So normally we ask then now the question to raise the hands and ask if somebody has a Netflix connection or video on demand with Amazon in the market now as well, and Disney. So we like to turn the question around and we like to call out anybody in these times of the corona crisis who does not have a subscription to a video on demand. So if somebody likes to call out if that's so, and what is this person doing instead of binge watching at night in these days, maybe they can inspire us by showing other things we can do. So very looking forward to see the answer. And Roland, so let's see if some answers are coming. Yeah. Another question here and topic here, of course, is about the newspaper. This is how I consume it on the Saturday. But the rest of the week, for me, it's all about consuming it on my phone and in a very fast way. The other thing, of course, very common now in these days is not the willingness of not going to the hospital. But it can also be done differently. You're looking at GD Health here, part of the big Chinese company, the shopping company, started out as a shopping company, but they also have GD Health, on which you see here real doctors. So these are the doctors that are also in the IC, commenting and helping people on distance with their questions. And you really see that this is taking up amazing speed now in China, in that sense. The other thing, of course, in these times, we are not able to go out, meet other people. So luckily, we already had some new channels on doing this via Tinder, connecting to new people and find like-minded people. So we see these shifts already going on, and we now see with Corona that they are rapidly going faster and faster. So questions, because I now like to switch to Roland. And as said, Roland is going to take us in our point of view. But if there are any questions, please drop them in the chat. Roland, did there got any responses from people that do not have an...
No response at all. So everybody is binge watching.
So we have 100% score on on-demand videos at this time. So Roland, if you would like to step forward,
sure.
And take us in our view of how we look at the digital shift.
Sure, I would love to do that. So even a couple of years ago, I think 3 or 4 years ago, when we asked this question, how many of you guys in the audience has Netflix? There were still some people that didn't have it, but now everybody has some kind of a video on demand subscription to entertain themselves. So this is all driven, this digital shift, by technology. That's a major driver, but the fact is it's not about the technology at all. It's really the technology that enables the digital shift to create value in a different way. So we have the internet that connects everyone and everything in the world. And that's, of course, the infrastructure that we use to build digital business models. And many new companies have been born out of the internet because of the internet. There's also mobile devices, our smartphones, so that we can get anything we want, any information we want, on demand, when we travel, wherever we are. And there's also this Internet of Things that's evolving, and that's trying to make every dumb device smart, but also come up with new applications that create value in a new way. So, for example, one of my hobbies is playing around with this stuff. And this is a very cheap controller that you can buy and that you connect to the internet, to LoRa, that is a connection protocol that you can use to send small messages over a long range. And it's only $20 to buy this and to play around with. So the digital shift, it's also really accessible for everybody to start playing around with, even in your personal lives. And there is, of course, these things like robotics, where these digital creatures help us and support us in any way and to service us. Because we are people, changing takes time, and before actually technology is embraced and adopted by people and gets to 50 million users, that takes some time, and we have seen that through history. So the first example, and this is my favorite technology because my background is in aeronautics, is the airplane. And it took 68 years before 50 million people were using air transport to move around the globe. The car, it took 62 years to get to 50 million users. And the smartphone, it still took 12 years before 50 million people were using this this technology. Then things accelerated, and it only took 3 years before 50 million people were using social media, and only 19 days before we achieved 50 million people using Pokemon to find these digital creatures in the physical world. That was quite funny, you think? Don't you think, Michiel? We were all addicted, especially our children, to these devices, our PlayStations, and then all of a sudden something appeared that actually brought them out into the physical world through digital means.
Yeah, I really love this topic. And I do have an update, Roland.
Okay.
Because we get a more of a trending one back to the Netflix.
Ah, okay.
Luckily, not everything is digital because Angela called out that she doesn't have on-demand.
Okay, okay,
and,
very good.
She's doing a lot of mindfulness, or she reads a book.
Ah, okay.
So next to these fast upcoming trends, you also still see that there's a counterbalance, right?
Okay. Yeah, and I also love to read books and write them as well. Okay. A book, I think it's still a great means to dive into. Okay, so, it's really also accelerated. So I was kind of a skeptic of these chatbots and robotics. Could they really help and empathize with people and do something on the emotional level. And what arrived in my mailbox 2 days ago from CB Insights is news about this startup, Replica, who has this chatbot that is used in therapy, mental health, and actually 40% of their users really sees their app, their chatbot, as a romantic partner that helps them to get through the day. And especially now, this is of course important, because if you're already lonely, like this person, Michael, then a partner really helps. And if you don't have a human and this chatbot can fulfill this emotional need, that is quite powerful. And that's actually already happening today. I didn't even know that. But here you see that the chatbot is actually checking in on Michael to see, okay, how are you doing? How's your health? How's that cold? Did it become worse? No, I'm fine again. So very good to see that also this is evolving and going to the emotional level even. So quite fascinating. And here, the most important question, of course, is why is this shift happening? Why are things shifting from physical to digital? And that's what we're exploring in the book with all the other shifts as well. So why is this happening? And what we see in terms of the digital shift is that it's happening because of us humans. We prefer easy over complicated. So if we can use digital means or a digital way to get easier access to products and services, that is what we will gravitate towards. If it becomes more personal instead of transactional and more customized, we will gravitate toward those models and those products and services and that value creation, those businesses. Also, if we are given more flexibility to do whatever we want in our lives and we can do it 24/7, place an order, get whatever we need and get it everywhere we are, we prefer that as well. And the fourth thing is convenience getting this seamless experience instead of an experience that is hampered, that is stuck. You're on the phone with a company and nobody responds. If that is replaced by convenience through a digital business model, that is what we gravitate towards as humans and as consumers and as customers. And basically it comes down that we have quite some things going on in our lives and everything that makes it more simple, that can simplify our lives, that is what we prefer instead. So this is kind of why the digital shift is happening. And well, sometimes we also get this question, okay, is the digital shift, how is it related to digital transformation? What is digital transformation about? And we, in our new book, which is about the business model shifts, we avoid the word transformation because it's so big and kind of in the media, it appears as if these things happen overnight. And this was quite funny. 2 years ago, then Reed Hastings, the founder and CEO of Netflix, was in the late night show on Dutch television here with Wendy, a famous Dutch host on television. And Umberto Tan was saying to Reed Hastings, well, what you've accomplished with Netflix and how many people are using it and all the technology that's behind it, it's amazing. What a big transformation that is. And then he said, well, actually, the transformation wasn't about the technology and isn't about how clever we are with all our servers and everything that's behind Netflix. The transformation that we saw was about customers. What we were envisioning was people spending their time, their leisure time, differently in the evenings, on the couch, with their loved ones, with their families, with their friends. That is what we envisioned. And based on that vision, we built Netflix and we thought about how can we best serve our customers to give them the entertainment and the lives that they want. So that was quite interesting to hear from him, from a tech company, as we like to call them. So let's dive into the shift and how we see it. If you see it differently, we would really like to know. So send in your perspective as well. This is how we look at it. This is how our point of view. And we define the digital shift like this. It's really this move, this shift towards fully leveraging ICT and data science. Not because of the technology, not because of the science, the data, but really to engage, amaze, and connect to customers and keep connected. That's what, in our point of view, the digital shift is all about. And it's moving away from this physical model. And I'll show you the physical model. And I must say, in the book, what we do is to sketch out what we're moving away from. We exaggerate this a little bit. It's not that we are saying physical models are bad or they're not a good thing, but we exaggerate this a little bit to really make it more clear what we're moving away from. So let's have a look at that. So if we look at a physical business model that we used to have, then of course we have to have a customer that we serve there. And let's see. We offer them a physical product and or a service that we deliver to them to their door. Oh, it's not reacting. Technology. Okay, let's do it like this. And the sale is really a physical sale, a physical transaction. Usually the relation we have with customers is really transactional. So if you, for example, look at record companies, they didn't have a relation with their customers because they didn't know who that customer was. And that is very different from Spotify, that really knows who their customers are, what they are doing, what their preferences are, what music they like and don't like. It's also about physical challenge, a store where we deliver the value or where you can go to get the value. And most of the time, obviously, there is a website where you can go to and maybe look up the company, but it's not really connected and integrated to the business model. On the left-hand side of the business model, in terms of activities, what we most often see in these purely physical business models is that there are systems and there are people, employees, but they are mostly processing data multiple times. So you come to their store and they will say to you, well, do you already have our loyalty card? Yes, I have it. Oh, I cannot find you in the system. That's because it has never been designed as a digital business. That's also because there are these legacy systems, this old software that is hard to connect to new software. And if you would like to do that, it is possible, but you need an IT partner that will propose you an IT project that will take 3 years to change something in your business, which is going to cost you a lot of money. So it's quite expensive to change something in this business model. So this is a little bit exaggerated, but this is the model that we're moving away from. So if we then move to this digital model, we see that we're moving towards business model that are more frictionless, where things are better connected in the business model. And it's moving towards creating more customer value and more relevance for customers. And if we look at such a model, then here you see it. So here in the dotted post-its, you still see the physical elements that we had. And if we're shifting, obviously, we still have our customers. And those can be the same customers. But what you often see when you shift towards a digital business model is that you are able to serve a whole new customer segment. And we'll see some examples of that later. So a digital model is also an opportunity to grow and to serve new customer segments. Of course, it's not about the physical product or the service anymore. It's more about a customer experience end-to-end that provides this convenience, speed, access. It's simple, it's easy, and you get the value that you want. What you then see in terms of sales, it's not the physical sales anymore. What you often see in digital models is that they use a different revenue model. It's called the freemium model. You might know it from business model generation. But why is that? Because people here have to get used to this digital experience. What these companies do is they provide a flavor of the digital experience for free. You can try it out. If you like it, then you start paying for the premium service. And that is what you see here. And that's a good way to onboard people onto your digital, into your digital business, and to get them used to what you're offering. And of course, instead of just generating money, also a lot of data is generated about your users that you can use to make the business model better. Instead of this transactional relationship, the relationship is much more connected. So you know your customers are always online. So there's also the opportunity to connect with them all the time and to be of service all the time with a digital business model. And obviously, instead of the physical stores and just a plain website that doesn't do anything, people can access your content or your value in any way possible through every device. And it doesn't mean that you don't have physical assets anymore. You can still have physical stores like what you see with Coolblue in the Netherlands, but it's enabled by the digital model. When we then move to the left-hand side of the business model, we see that because everything is connected in this model in terms of processes and the systems that you have, you can really focus on designing the customer experience and also make sure that you track the customers in this customer experience and make sure that you know when new needs arise, when they want something from you. You can be much more proactive and serve your customers. Instead of the legacy systems, you'll have a much more adaptable stack of systems and technologies that are connected by smart algorithms and the data that is in those systems. And this also means that you won't work with this big IT company anymore that is very rigid, but you'll probably work with specialized IT companies or tech providers that are really good at, for example, this data science or technology that you need to enable your business. So that's also a different relationship that you'll have with those partners. And instead of spending a lot of money on expensive systems and building something in a big bang and launching a new system 3 years from now, you'll actually constantly adapt your systems so that you can experiment with value creation all the time. That's what we see in the digital shift.
Yeah, I love it. And I think it's also interesting to add to the part where it's about strongly connected and all devices and physical.
Yeah,
Because we also had Mathieu call out in the chat that he doesn't have an account on Netflix, but he uses the account of a friend.
Ah, okay.
Yeah, so you also see that on any device, it's being brought to you, right,
yeah,
Ronan?
Yeah, right. Okay. So the digital, it's really what we also say in the new book. Some of you might already have proofread the chapter. It's not about the digital technology, but it's enabling better value creation. And this also means that the value creation that you do can be different. So you might have a business that serves just a functional need, but could it be possible that because you're using digital technologies, that you'll be able to serve emotional needs like we saw with the chatbot? I didn't know that, but they're actually moving from functional to emotional because these digital technologies become so smart and become more human and can really have this empathy. Or would you like to do something with your digital model that really changes the lives of people and how we are entertained and spend our time in our lives with our loved ones? That could also be an opportunity. So there's an opportunity here to innovate, and it's always up to you as a business leader and entrepreneurs to decide, okay, where would we like to be relevant and create the value? And using this impact period, it helps to make that choice and to come up with a vision. So let's, yeah.
Yeah, Ronan, thank you for this already. So if there are any questions on this part,
sure,
share them with us in the chat or any reflections. Love to hear from you. What I find very interesting, Ronan, is also the fresh watching that you guys have done for the book. We analyzed over 150 business models, right?
Yeah.
We're going to pick out one, talking about moving up in the pyramid to self-realization. We keep that a bit for now, but we also look at patterns, right?
Yeah.
And for this part, we identified four patterns,
yeah,
right?
That's right.
Where it is. Could you take us, what's the first pattern that we've seen?
Yeah, so
what is a pattern?
Yeah. So what is a pattern? So before we dive into the patterns that we see, and it's perfectly fine if you see different patterns, because that's the cool thing about recognizing and identifying patterns. So patterns is really about looking at all these different business models and then trying to identify what's different about them. And what's also common about it. So the commonalities, if you discover those, then you could say, well, hey, here we discover a pattern. All from all these 10 models, we see similar things that they do in their business, either on the right-hand side of the model, on the value creation part, or how they organize the value creation on the left-hand side. And that's what we call a pattern. And you can identify patterns in a different way. But what we did here actually is we decided to look at patterns on this gliding scale from really starting out from what they call a business that is born digital, that is digital native. It started as a digital model, so it actually got right into the digital shift. And then a gliding scale towards a business model that is still quite physical, and just adding some digital stuff. Cool. So that's how we looked at patterns here.
So could you take us into the first pattern? Can you give us an example of that pattern?
Sure. So the first pattern that we see is the digital native. So those are those companies that build these business models based on the internet, the digital native models. They're fully digital. And an example of that is actually a company that still delivers a lot of physical goods, Picnic. They are an online grocery business here in the Netherlands, but they are built as a digital business model. So instead of guessing what their customers would like to order and would like to eat, once this business starts, they exactly know what people prefer and what they're ordering, and they use this to create better value. What you see here, although this is set up as a digital business, they needed to step up their game. Michiel Müller was on Eva Jinek 2 weeks ago, I think, and he was saying, well, we opened a new physical distribution center right now in Apeldoorn instead of the planned date in December, because we really have a promise to make to our customers that we will always deliver their groceries on time. And especially now that is important. So that's why we expanded the physical. But they are able to also do this fast because they have the digital business model. So for them, it's easier to connect and serve all those customers. Another well-known example is, of course, Jeff Bezos. And I mentioned the interview, and you have to look it up. We'll send you the link from 1999, where he was explaining, again, it's not about digital at all. It's about serving this customer. And they are in a bit of trouble now. So they are a digital native business. And they said, well, if you get Amazon Prime from us, we'll promise you to deliver everything you order within just 1 day or 2 days. And they're having a hard time right now because everybody is using it and they cannot hold up their promise. So even if you have a digital business model, it can be tough to be in business, but that hasn't changed at all. So this is the first pattern.
Yeah, what's the second one?
The second one is really when you move your physical business model and you shift it, but you really create a digital value proposition. So it can be a digital product, can be a digital service, and it coexists next to the physical product that you already have. So a famous example is the New York Times. Mm-hmm. They saw their a print business declining because advertising was declining. It was going online. So it was a tough time for them to keep in this business. And they changed it, but they didn't shift completely to only digital. What they did is they added a digital product and they figured out it's really, people really would like to be served the news, but they would like to consume it in a different way now. They would like to read the news when it's convenient for them, which doesn't mean right in the morning, spend an hour on the paper, but you might have a couple of minutes to read an article. And then their digital product, their subscription really helps you to do that and to consume that value. And when they were doing this, they also thought about, okay, what else can we do? And they decided to also create digital crosswords. And this is really a favorite, one of the favorite products that really works well for them. So you see here, there's a mix between the physical and the digital.
The third one, yeah.
Yeah, the third one, that is really where you apply digital technologies to enable the relationship with your customers or delivering the value. So really enabling the channels, turning that those into digital or the relationship. And that's what we called digital connection. And an example is, and KLM is, I think, well known for starting this early. They started with the social media team and they figured, well, if we have this social media team, we can use that team not only to talk about KLM, but actually to help our customers and to help them out, to give them a hand, to service them. And they're doing that all the time. And even they had a while ago a campaign, Happy to Help, and they actually helped any traveler, not only the KLM, but any traveler to arrive at their destination on time.
Yeah.
And you have an experience, right?
Yeah, I love it. I was working for a client in Bulgaria at the moment when the Corona crisis hit.
Yeah.
It's amazing what those guys did. I just booked a new flight earlier and I only had contact via the chat. No any other interactions. It was done, it was worked by. So I like this and I think it's very interesting to see next to the physical product that they really deliver value that will keep me stick to
frictionless and you were at home
with my family
with
safe.
The family safe
so I like it. I just like to call out that we get a lot of questions now, so that's nice. And Peter is also calling out that it's a very nice framing. He liked it a lot, how the digital ship was framed. I like to call out to other people, rate the other questions, because there's a lot, so we may not be able to answer them all.
Sure.
But if you really like a question to be answered, hit the thumbs up, and then we'll get some winners that we're going to shoot to you, Roland, a little later.
Yeah.
But this was... This one, right? So
yep.
There's another one still.
Yeah, and the final one, that is what we call bolted on. And this is a pattern that we see. It's actually where a company says, okay, we don't really want to change anything, but let's have an app, right? Because everybody is having an app. And we've seen this many times. We don't see this so often these days, but I remember from 5 or 6 years ago that we have many customers that we did strategy projects with, and they actually came in with the question, okay, we should change, we should also have an app. And then when we asked them this question, they didn't have a clue and they didn't know why to do it. So this is what you still see. So people are bolting on a website or an app, and it's not really connected to the business or to a business goal or to creating value for customers. So that's the fourth pattern we see, just to make you aware of where it can go wrong.
Yeah.
Okay.
Let's dive into a value creation story. We promised this, right, Roland?
Yeah.
So this story should help you, right? Think about the next slide, Roland.
Yeah, sure.
Think about what you can learn from your business. So what are aha moments that you have when Roland is taking us into this story? And if you like, share them on the chat, because we can also then react on it if we see nice things coming by. And the story is about, Roland, is about the Duolingo, right? It's about a very interesting company that is into learning languages.
Yep.
And we are very curious to know if any of you listeners are users of Duolingo. So if you are, can you raise your hand in the chat and also call out which language you have studied or you are studying at the moment, to just have a little competition by the side while Roland is telling the story about Duolingo. Yeah, please submit.
Okay, we'll get back to the numbers in a couple of minutes. So in 2009, Duolingo was founded, and by this guy, Louis Fornan, and he's from Guatemala. He has German roots. And he actually was lucky, because in Guatemala he could go to a private school where he learned English, But he also saw in his country and people around him, other students, other people, that weren't so lucky to get really get world-class English education. So that is his situation. And then he moved to the US and he became a professor and also an entrepreneur. Of course, that's what you do when you go to the US. And he is actually at Carnegie Mellon University. That is where he is a professor, but he's also an entrepreneur. And what he likes to do is he likes to work on problems that cannot be solved by a human alone, but also not by a computer alone. So it's always the combination between human and computers. That is what the combination that he would like to make. And one of the earlier businesses and things that he worked on and that you might know, I think you all use it, even if you don't realize it, it's ReCAPTCHA. So before ReCAPTCHA, there was CAPTCHA, that was invented by Louis von Ahm, in order to make sure that if there's somebody using a website, that it's really a person, a human of flesh and blood, instead of a bot that is trying to tweak the system and to break into a system or to do things that aren't meant to be. So this is making sure that we're dealing with humans if they interact with us in the digital world. And the funny thing with ReCAPTCHA, what he did in 2007, is actually that we are using this to identify us as a person. So we actually type in the words, and at the back end, these words are the words that a computer cannot identify very well from text that they are trying to digitize. So they're digitizing books using this system, and a computer has a hard time reading some of the words, but we can give them to humans, to us, on a website like this, to make sure that this is done. So this is the kind of stuff that Louis von Ahm likes to work on, and this is some of the, this is a nice thing that he worked on that was later sold to Google. So just some background on how he is looking at the world. And the other thing is that when they started Duolingo together with one of his students, he actually wanted to help people at the top of the needs pyramid, because he said, well, if you're not able to learn English, that could also mean that you're not able to get a very good job. So English, especially in the emerging economies, is really also helping people get a better job that sometimes has or often has twice the income that people then can earn. So it's also really related to self-actualization, making sure that people can develop themselves because they learn a language, they learn English. And this is what he said about it. So true equality is really been, you don't need money to get a good education. That's how they started the business. That's their vision. What they did actually in the beginning, and this is related to also the CAPTCHA. CAPTCHA is serving two needs. And this is also how they started Duolingo. So initially Duolingo was helping people to learn a language. So they had to translate text to learn English, or they had to translate something to Spanish. And actually what Duolingo was doing at the back end of the business, they were selling the translations that everybody was making because they were practicing the language. They were selling that to CNN and to BuzzFeed because those companies needed translations for their websites, for their global websites. That's how they started. That's the business model that they had. And that was kind of a B2B business model where they sold the translations to companies. That is what they changed. It's now different, and I'll show you in a minute. But what also happened is that there apparently was a really big need. A lot of people had this need to learn this language in a different way. So not in a traditional way. So digital actually enabled them with Duolingo to learn a language in a really different way. And in 2013-14, it was the most downloaded app of all times. And this is what you see. So if you decide to go to Duolingo to download the app on your phone, you really get a good onboarding experience, because for them it's really important to connect right away to the customer. because customers have to start using the app, have to start learning the language, and have to have fun with it. So the onboarding in a digital model, it's really important. And here you see that you can actually, you are actually challenged. Okay, what is your personal goal? And they make it personal for you. Well, I would like to study in a more casual way, or really in this insane way. I would like to spend 20 minutes a day to get better at this language. And here they say, okay, it's fine. You can always change goals later. So here you see it's already personalized. What they then also do is they do a quick test to see how proficient you are in a language so that they know at what level you are, so they can offer you the right value and the right learning exercises to move ahead. And what they've done is they've gamified learning. So here you see that you can compete with your friends. You get badges, you get points, you get XPs, all the stuff that our kids have when they play a game, you can also do in Duolingo. And that's really what engages people to do this. At the same time, it's not just another game, because you really see how you're moving ahead. So you really get insight into your skill level and how it's developing and where you're stuck and where you need to spend more time on the learning. So that's also what we saw in the digital shift business model, that you're able to track what your users are doing and how they're progressing on their goals that you would like to help them achieve with your business. What they did later, they later started to sell language certificates. They're usually also expensive. And I think, if I remember it correctly, it's around 40 euros to get your certificate if you go through the training. And it's accepted by international companies. So if, for example, for Uber, you need to speak English, they will accept a Duolingo certificate. And you're much better off. It's a much cheaper option to get your certificate and to get the employment you need. So here again, you see it's connected to the emotional needs of their customers again, to make sure they get ahead in life. This was the change that they made when they needed to switch. So they couldn't keep selling the translations to other businesses anymore. That didn't help them provide the customer experience they need. So they introduced ads. So it's now also ad-based. You can get rid of the ads if you want, and then you have a Duolingo Plus. And they actually say, well, this also pays for free education for others.
Well, yeah, but before we dive into the more technical part, so let's just call out that we have a winner. People using this for learning Spanish.
Cool. Who is it?
Spanish is the language that's been done the most. See? I also loved Charlotte, and she's emphasizing what you said. So she was studying Italian.
Okay.
Still is not really good at it, but she loved that's what she says herself, right?
Didn't know. Yeah, yeah.
And she really also loves the gamification part.
Okay, cool.
That was really helping her to progress, you call out. Let's dive into the business model.
Yeah, so this is already a sneak peek at how we visualize the business models in the book. It doesn't look this sharp, but in the book it will look very fancy. But this is how we iconize all the models. So what you see, that their customer segment is learners with a lack of time and money. Really people that would like to learn the language but don't want to spend hundreds of dollars and also don't have a lot of time on their hands to do so. So they are offered learning in a fun way. It's bite-sized. It's your personal tutor, and you can learn wherever you are and whenever you want. And it's also fun. You see here that they have this freemium model. So you can use it for free, but then you have to digest an ad. Not all the time, but you will see those ads. You can also get rid of it, and then you'll pay for the Duolingo Plus version. You pay a small fee, and then you actually support free educations for others as well. So that is where they generate revenue from ads from companies that would like to advertise with them. We don't show them in the model here, but that's how they make it work financially. Of course, the channel, it's really the app. that you use to digest the value, to consume the value. It's learning on demand, so it's really personalized, and there is also this community. So the people that are learning a language or that are already fluent at a language, they are also onboarded to help build learning exercises, translate things. So these users are also actively involved in making Duolingo better. So what do they have to do on the left-hand side of the business model to make this work? Well, what you see here is they are continuously improving and measuring how well this model is working. If their users get the results that they need, they measure this, they improve this all the time. What they also do, and that is of course related to more the academic background of Louis van An and his co-founder, is they actually are also using all this data to research the nature of language and how people learn a language. And what they're doing is actually they're publishing this for others to use to really move the field of language learning to the next level. So that is also an amazing thing you can do if you open up this data with such a model. What you then see in terms of their resources, of course, they have all these algorithms and machine learning to make sense of the data, how people are learning. And another resource that they have is they also have an incubator where they can start adding new languages and see if there is traction to figure out what is the best way to teach people those new languages. They also have many partners, so educational partners. Like I said, the community that really contributes to adding elements to the courses. And of course, their investors. So their latest investor was Alphabet's Capital G. That invested a lot of money again last year in this model. Their cost structure is, of course, they have to do R&D, develop it, and maintain it, and they really work in teams. So it's not that there is people who only work on the language part. No, it's really a multidisciplinary team where the data scientists, the UX people, and the people that really know about language, the linguistics, that's a difficult word. Those scientists are really in the same team to build out this value creation. What's interesting is that you might think, okay, so this is a digital native, fully digital. But what is happening here is that this model is also moving to the physical space because it's actually used in schools and by governments because they see this is a very effective model for learning. And actually, teachers are also using this in their classroom to support the physical learning that they already do. So it's a combination of physical and digital, and that is what we see more often with these models. It's not digital or physical, but actually you see them making the combination.
Okay.
Yeah. So this is the Duolingo model.
And they're growing very rapidly, right? Can you do
that's right.
From 300,000
yeah, it's now 300 million registered users with wow. 30 million people. And this is really important, not that you measure how many users do you have, but how many are active.
Right.
So 30 million monthly active.
Yeah.
And right now their valuation is at 1.5 billion. So, Michiel.
There are some cool questions that came in.
Cool.
So let's go to the Q&A. Can you get?
Yeah. So just to summarize, this is really digitally enabled. They test everything to make sure that they create the right value.
Yeah.
It's gamified to make it engaging, and yes, there's still a lot of people involved from their side, but also from the community that work together to make the model better.
Cool.
And just a funny note: if you ever wanted to learn Klingon, you can also do that from the language from Star Trek.
Okay.
But let's go to the Q&A.
Yeah, let's click to the Q&A slide. And we had a discussion going, why should you learn Albania in the chat? Because it's a beautiful country, Britta entered, and that you really definitely have to go there. So there's also some advertising being done in the chat, but that's not what we're going to talk about. So the first question I like to give to you, Roland, is of Yolanda.
Yeah.
And her question is where to start with a digital shift. start from a revenue perspective, start from a value value proposition. What would you recommend?
Yeah, so what we always say, if you look at a business model, and you can actually start from your current model. So if you look at your current model, and that is what we call the epicenter approach of innovation, the innovation technique. And I heard Michiel say, well, what if we started from a revenue perspective? Then we could say, okay, let's change our model, shift it to digital so that we make a lot of money here. So maybe that we earn 30% of revenues also from a digital value proposition. And this is a possibility, but for me, and we also know from our clients, it's really difficult then to imagine, okay, but what will this be? What will be the value that is created to come up with the 30% of revenues? And this is also, for example, what the New York Times struggled with, because they saw the revenues from their current model. It was going, the current revenue was going like this, down. And then you can say, okay, we have to replace the fall of revenue by new revenue. But that's very hard to do. So what they actually did, they went on a journey to discover, and we call it customer development, to really figure out what is a need that these customers have that are now in this digital world that we can serve them with. And that is how the New York Times did it. So I would really start with the customer. Yeah. The current need that they have, is it still the right way to serve them with your physical value proposition, or would they be better off if you would have a digital digital proposition? And then don't just replace the physical with a digital one, but think about, okay, what will then be different in this value proposition to make it even more relevant? So I would start with the customers. Go to your customers.
Okay, cool. Thank you, Roland, for that. So and the second question is from Austin, and also emphasized by Britta. It's about moving up in the value chain.
Yeah.
What is changing in your business model? Where do you see the big changes?
Okay. If you move up in the value chain, then I think that, for example, I would like to give an example of the oncology center that we worked with a couple of years ago. That was really about moving up in the value chain. So you can also enable that digitally. So if you have an oncology center where patients come in to get their cancer treatment, actually a digital model would make sure that there is really this end-to-end experience that customers have. So instead of just seeing them when they come into your center, you can actually facilitate a much bigger customer journey. You might see them in your physical space here in your center, yeah, because they get the treatment, but you will differentiate yourself and move up the value chain to this point where you really offer the experience where people say, well, I prefer to go to Maastricht instead of another hospital, because what I get from them is 3 or 4 weeks before I get my treatment, I'm prepared. So I get a video of what will happen to me. I get a diet by meal to prepare myself to be in the best condition I can be to really get into this treatment in the right way.
Cool. So it's really about centralizing the customers, setting them up, and also setting that up for your stakeholders and shareholders that are in your company.
Right.
That's the biggest value, and not only the the numbers only, right?
That's right. And what you see is then also a digital model. You won't have to do that alone, because you will work with food experts to help those people to prepare in the best way. So that also changes. Yeah.
Cool. Okay, that's what the two questions that we had. We are almost on closing time, but we do like to end up with you guys, and we are currently also see, and that's what we want to end up with you guys, that the COVID-19, of course. And the question is this an accelerator for the digital shift? What do you guys think? Looking at this, right, from this perspective, that customer behavior is changing very fast, and that we also see that we use different tools now to work in this world and to be able to, as a consumer, from a consumer perspective, be able to do our thing. Like, how busy is it with the Albert Heijn before you go to the Albert Heijn? I have never done that before the COVID outbreak, and I'm now using this. Also, of course, the amazing amount of people now using the grocery delivery at home. It trifolded. It was amazing what's happening. Like Roland also called out with Picnic, but also the delivery with Uber Eats. A lot of companies connecting, but also high-end companies now function as dark stores. Instead of coming in, the star restaurants are bringing the food to your home. And of course, the pub quiz. What we normally went out for, we now see amazing amount of invites for e-pub quizzes with your company and with your business. And of course, also the I was called out by the neighbor of mine about the fact that he is digitally now connecting to his grandparents and let them babysit their daughter when they're doing other things, and she's carrying grandma through the house. So we see those kind of shifts now made because there is a new reality that come in. Of course, that's also being done in the office, right? Not allowed to be in. We now see companies shifting into other ways of doing live meetings and work. And also in our line of business, we totally changed our approach to strategy. And we are now delivering fully digital strategy as we are doing today. Also with the Surface Hub that we are working on, really changing not only in a small but in a total way. The question, of course, is will this stick around after the crisis? So we're very curious if what you guys think, if this is true. Roland, what's your thought on this? Will it stick around after the crisis?
That's hard to say, I think, but like you said, it's really about if there's value in it, then it will stick around. That's important all the time. So I think the things that you change right now, if you see that it's really helping and creating more value for your customers, yeah, you should keep doing that also after this crisis.
Yeah,
let's keep that. But if it doesn't add value, then get rid of it.
Okay, so you say it's accelerating, but you have to look at the new normal you get in.
Yeah.
And then also see if it works.
Yeah.
There's also an interesting example of things that are now happening that were already planned, right? This is
yeah,
an
yeah.
example of the Gemeente Hoorn, who set out a digital store,
yeah.
wanted to plan this for a longer time, but
right.
now it's speed up
yeah.
and it's there. And now it has to prove itself
yeah.
after the Corona
Absolutely.
Time if
yeah.
it stays there.
Yeah. Yeah.
So interesting. So I'm very interested if there are any things came up, because we're going to close off because we're already 5 o'clock. So if you scroll down.
Okay, here Yolanda is saying, the digital education.
Digital education, yeah.
My kids are really adopting it very easily.
Yeah.
And Christine is also saying it is an accelerator. Our usual services in real life, although digital support was invented, it was not just adopted by our workers, and now they apparently do.
Yeah.
Also, Britta is saying it also depends on the customer needs after the crisis.
Yeah.
Will they still exist? Yeah, of course. If the need isn't there,
yeah.
You shouldn't be doing it. Here's somebody else. Of course, definitely. Here Jan is also saying, well, it's a matter of pain and gain. And
it's a matter of pain.
We always say the pain and the gains of the customers.
Yeah.
If you can address those, then it will stick. Yes, somebody said it's an amazing accelerator, is Peter saying, and I think it might also depend on the mindset that you have as a company. So you could also say, okay, let's use this now to really accelerate some of the things that we have been holding off, so like the city of Hoorn is now doing to help the physical stores in their town, and let's use that to accelerate it now. And not let go of it later. So
cool.
that's kind of summarizing and experimenting with it. So that's also great here, and I think that nicely ties into the wrap-up that you're going to do.
So we definitely really liked the time we have had together. So if you guys have any thoughts or questions left, throw them through us through the chat or via email when we send out the recap, and we will share the slides with you. Before we do that, three things that we like to give as a takeout is the first thing is to really set a business goal. Why is it that you want to drive this change? What is the need of the customer? What's the pain in the gain that's being called out? But do it from that perspective, as Roland called out, from the customer angle, and see where your strengths are. Really have technology as an enabler, but it's the value you're creating for your customer that's driving this. The second one is do a test small. Don't go for the big bang. Try it in small tests. Try different technologies. See what sticks and what not will stick. And use a methodological approach to this. That's the recommendation. And the third recommendation, in this process, stay human. Be connecting to customers. Customers want to buy from customers or have the feeling they're buying from customers. Also, like Uber is doing this via the rating, via the pictures, really trying to make it a human interaction and have people feel that part. So those are the three things we really, at the end of this, Inspire's like to give you. Bring it and make the human smarter in that sense. The next BMI Inspires will be May 14th. We'll then talk about another part, another shift that we see, the stakeholder shift. We hope to see you there, and we hope to connect you in such a very interactive way as we did this time. So very happy if you can join us there and then. We will send out the deck. We also still like some readers, pre-readers for the stakeholder shift that's coming out. Yeah. So if you like that, also there will be a link where you can apply to become a pre-reader to the book. Love that. With it, we really liked having you here. Roland, thank you very much for sharing your knowledge.
Yeah, thanks for joining, everybody.
And stay safe and hope to see you in the next time around. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.